Strategic News International and Bharat Shakti's founder and editor-in-chief Nitin Gokhale has authored a book on RN Kao, about whom very little is known, in fact, publicly or even of his private life. Nitin joins us now for more on this. I think the book will be out in stores and online by mid-November or so, right?
That's right. In fact, that is the date which the publishers have decided. It is a very urgent project that I did. Actually, the conceptualization happened in mid-July, and now we are towards the beginning of November. So, within these 4 months, this book was conceived, researched and written. So, that was the beginning of the project. And I'm happy to have done this book because, like you said, very little is known about this man. Although, there is a lot of mystery around him, and rightfully so, because he was an intensely private man. And was also somebody who built institutions which are of national security importance, or institutions which contribute to national security. And that is why it was important.
In fact, you write in your book that this is in the blurb itself as well, that this is not a detective thriller. It's not part of history. It's not a comprehensive look at R&AW as well. So how should this book be looked at? Because it's extremely easy reading.
It is meant to be an easy read because all my books have been like that. I mean, I have tried to simplify or make readable history, military history. So far, I have written books on military history and a couple of them on military operations in Sri Lanka and in the Northeast. But this one was particularly different and difficult both, because RNAW, which is Research and Analysis Wing and India's Foreign Intelligence Agency, was established in 1968. And there have been sporadic attempts by some of the practitioners or some of the officers of the RNAW to shed some light on how it functions, how it came about, all that had happened. But there was very little known or available in public domain about Rameshwar Nath Kao, who was the founder director of not only RNAW, but also something called the ARC, the Aviation Research Center, which predated RNAW and is a technical intelligence agency. He was also responsible for the SFF, the Special Frontier Force, and was in charge of the SSB in its earlier role. SSB, so in a way, he was a man who built many of the critical post-independence organizations, whereas the Intelligence Bureau predates independence, India's independence. But RNAW, ARC, SFF, they were all post-independence. And he played a major part in not only founding them, but also nurturing them to what they are right now. Therefore, it was difficult. Second, you mentioned that the blurb, that it's neither a history nor a biography nor a thriller. It is not a thriller because RN Kao was not a classical undercover agent. He never operated.
Your title itself illustrates that.
Exactly, Gentleman Spymaster. So he was a spy master, not a spy. He was an institution builder, not an operative.
Not a handler, but still had a huge amount of network.
Of course, he had networks, and he initially may have allowed other people in his team to handle it, but he always had the full picture of what he was doing. So he was a man who looked at the larger picture, and it is not a organization's history because many of its operations, and even the operations that I touch upon, are not fully covered because those papers are classified. So I had to actually juggle a lot of information and extract it from his family, his subordinates, some of his friends, some of the RNAW's own write-ups that had appeared in newspapers and other places, and some from memory of his associates. But the most important aspect of all this was that he himself had left behind, has left behind rather, about seven files of his entire life's journey, which includes his professional journey. And they are at the Nehru Memorial Museum and Library. But a typical cautious approach that he had that he had put a precondition that they were transcribed. Of course, he first taped them, and then he got it transcribed, and he corrected those transcriptions, which are now lying in the Nehru Memorial Museum and Library, the NMML. And in that, he had stipulated that the files will be progressively opened after his death. So, 5 years after his death, 10 years after his death, and the last three files, the most crucial files everybody would love to get their hands on, are to be opened in 2027, 25 years after his death. He passed away in February 2002. So, we are still about 8 years away from getting hold of those files. So, that was the challenge.
Again, you talked about how you've got access to information to write this book, and it deals all the way, like you said, something that's open is his childhood, is his how his parents brought him up, or his father, of course, died when both brothers were very young. I think the younger one was 3 or 4, maybe.
Born after his father died. He was 5, and his younger brother was born 3 months after his father died. So, yeah, so in fact, those files actually start from his early years and go on to as I said,
to they trace his coming in as a probationary officer in the police service in 1940, independence, the IPS, then going on to whether it's the RC, RAW, and all the operations that you were talking
Absolutely.
About.
Absolutely. So, the files that are open and accessible to researchers is his early life as a child, his difficult childhood with his grandparents and his uncles and his mother, all the details. Then his getting through to the Indian police in 1940 and how luck played part because the Second World War had begun. And they used to take 3 candidates from United Provinces where he was born and raised. That year in 1940, they decided to take 4 candidates or 4 officers, and he was the 4th one. Then he talks about his experience in the Moradabad training school, the police training school, his encounters with the British, and how he found them to be boorish and uncultured, especially the police officers, all that. And then he joins the IB in 1947. And that's where his rise really begins.
And the operations, some of the key operations, of course, which again shaped him for more international and gave him a lot of exposure, was the Kashmir Princess investigation, which he was sent.
It did. In fact, when he joined the IB, I think within 2 or 3 years, the second director of Intelligence Bureau, B.N. Malik, Bholanath Malik, assigned him to the Prime Minister's security detail as maybe number 2, number 3, whatever. So, he used to keep traveling with Jawaharlal Nehru, India's first Prime Minister. And in 1955, there was an Air India airplane which was chartered by the Chinese to take Chinese Premier Zhou Enlai to Bandung Conference, the first Afro-Asian conference. And that aircraft crashed off the coast of Indonesia. Sabotage was suspected. And then it was decided that the Chinese, the Hong Kong authorities, which was then under the British sovereignty, and India would collaborate in a joint investigation. So, he was handpicked and sent to join the investigation. He spent 6 months in Hong Kong, China, Indonesia, traveling that part. And that's where his first exposure to several British officers, the Chinese. Zhou Enlai actually hosted a special dinner for him in his honor. All that comes in. So, that was a detail. In fact, that part of his life covers 2 of my chapters. I mean, spread over 2 chapters there.
The intrigue, the various players, international players, and that too, the top leaders, when you're talking about an assassination attempt at Zhou Enlai, not giving out too many details
yes.
because we wanted everybody to read the book as well.
Yeah.
But he had other international exposure as well, now in Africa, in Ghana.
Exactly. So, in 1957, after he finished this assignment in early 1956, in 1957, he was chosen to go and set up the Foreign Intelligence yeah. Service for the newly independent country, Ghana. He spent a year there then came back and continued with the IB, rose through the ranks. In 1963, post the 1962 debacle, India wanted to set up a technical intelligence agency. And this is the irony, that the Americans helped set up the ARC, gave a lot of help to set up ARC, and he was the founding director of ARC again. So this is how he was there. Some people say he was the right man at the right place. Well, yes, but so many times, and he also made the best of the opportunities that he got. And that is where we come to, say, 1965, where India, in my view, won the war, but other people say that it was a draw with Pakistan, the war with Pakistan. And that's where then need was felt that there should be a separate external intelligence agency. The work started, or the conception started, in 66-67, and by the time Mrs. Indira Gandhi took over as Prime Minister in January 1966, I think it was decided by some of the people in the establishment that it should be there. So again, maybe a coincidence, maybe a thing, that he was already heading, RN Kao was heading the External Intelligence Division of the IB when it was finally decided that the RNAW will be formed. So he automatically inherited the external intelligence division's manpower and the leadership. So that's how it began.
When you're talking about the setting up of the ARC and the SSF, again, the intrigue between the US, China, India, and how it's playing out now. So it's a must-read book without giving out more details.
Yes.
But then post that, Pakistan. And a crucial bit of information that was also emanating from the top office in Pakistan.
In Pakistan in 1971. So the beauty of RN Kao was, or his strength was, that he could pick the right person, right man for the job, and delegate authority. And then also join the dots. So his role, he came into his own really, into the limelight, I would say, and yet remained in the shadows. Was the 1971 operation before the war began. The war began in December 1971, but from January 1971, the RNAW was on the ball, and it was not RN Kao alone. I mean, he had the network all right, but he had chosen the right people. There was a Bengali gentleman who was in Calcutta, who became a part of the Mujibur Rahman household.
Nath Babu.
Nath Babu. I will not give the full name, it will come out. SS Uban, Major General SS Uban, who was the IG, Inspector General of the SFF. SFF, incidentally, for those who don't know, comprises of the Tibetans who are supposed to operate behind enemy lines in Tibet if the balloon goes up. So they played a major role in training the Bangladeshis. There is an organization called Mujib Bahini, which was trained by the SFF. And Kao played a seminal role along with P.N. Haksar in joining the dots and carrying everyone along. Mrs. Gandhi, of course, gets the full credit for the leadership or the decision making. But these were the people who had crucial role in 1971.
If that was his best moment, or one of the best moments, a time came later involving Bangladesh again, where he got a lot of flak.
Yes.
And just in his own way, in his own personality, he brushed that off, right?
That's right. In fact, that is what you're talking about, is Mujibur Rahman assassination. In fact, RNAW was getting very, I would say, critical and confirmed inputs that Mujib's life was in danger by some of the army officers in the Bangladesh army in 1975. He, in fact, personally went to brief Mujib. He also told Mrs. Gandhi about this. But Mujib was in such a mood at that point in time that I am the father of the nation and nobody is going to harm me. He didn't listen to him. But when he was questioned, when RN Kao was questioned by a young police officer in a conference, he actually downplayed the whole thing and didn't sort of get rattled or didn't give any excuses. He said, we had all the information that was needed and we had tried to take whatever steps were needed. But it didn't happen. So he sort of was, you know, both in his triumph and his and tragedies, he was his equilibrium was something that was to be admired. And I think that is what comes out in this entire book, that he was a man who was intensely private, meticulous, team player and a great leader who would take the entire team along and give credit to the team and not take the whole credit himself, although people knew who was the leader.
He would never be in the limelight.
He was never be in the limelight.
In fact, he would shy away whenever the limelight would come,
yeah.
come to
him. So there are a couple of incidents I mentioned there that he did not like to be photographed. Although this is also a myth that if you go on internet, you will see that there are some writers which say he was only photographed twice in his life. But that's not true. I've got some 16 photographs in the book. So that's clearly not true. But yes, he was intensely private. And as you can see in the stipulation that he's made about the files not being opened, he was the one who believed that spies and undercover operatives and agencies or organizations like R&AW are meant to do their work without tom-tomming it. And I think he wanted the legacy to continue.
And that legacy was also built hugely with the operation in Sikkim, because one can imagine if that hadn't happened, the merger of Sikkim, and you're in situations with China, which are happening now, how much different things would have been?
Oh, it would have been very different. What happened in 2017 in Doklam. So he again was instrumental in leading the team, and a lot of people would see when they read the book that he had picked the right people. Again, Nath Babu played a major part until he passed away in Dhaka in 1974, a year before Sikkim was merged with India. But it was a very meticulous operation. It was a bloodless coup. The then king or Chogyal was ousted through a popular agitation, which was clearly instigated by India and by RNAW and other arms of the Indian government, which has been known, which people know about it. But his role and the way it was done and the kind of planning that went into it are something that I focused on. Maybe people will find it interesting.
Okay, going back to his personality, apart from being a great institution builder itself and his shy personality, but if you look at the pictures and the tales that are, anecdotes that are recounted, extremely dapper, extremely well groomed, either in a three-piece suit or it was a khaki kind of shirt in the summers.
Yeah, summer. Yeah.
That was the man. I mean, he
was
impeccable.
Very, very stylish, very stylish, and he loved...
Something straight out of John Le Carré.
John Le Carré, exactly. So, actually, if one has to, you know, write one small article, which can be titled that more George Smiley than James Bond.
Yeah,
he looked like James Bond, dashing as James Bond as we see in the movies, but he operated in the shadows. He was, as I said, very particular. He was very punctual. He was a pakka British sahib in a sense, but he was not boorish, and he makes that distinction. Like his daughter. Yeah. Makes this point that in Hindi he used to tell her ki kaam karo nasihat mat do, don't give advice,
lead by example
is what he used to say, and that he followed all through. He was very punctual. So one of the later years RNAW chief, he went on to call on him one evening, and he was late by about 15 minutes. And RN Kao made his displeasure known very visibly. But within 2 minutes, after having made known that displeasure, he became a gracious host. He was a great host, as people recount. RNAW started a Club 71, in fact, in post the 71 Bangladesh operations. And that was a very cozy family kind of an atmosphere where everyone would get together. Mr. and Mrs. Kao used to know each and every junior officer or their families. So that was a small organization at that point in time. And they all took great pride in being members of that, what was known as an elite organization at that point in time. It had a great prestige. It had great standing. And I consider RNAW as one of the great success stories post-India. That is all.
Just to point out again, in the foreword, NSA Ajit Doval talks about how his widow, 99-year-old Malini, has given her blessings to this book. He got a lot of information from the family, which was stored away for decades now.
Exactly.
But they feel that this was a man who they can look back on with extreme pride. There are some anecdotes that his daughter talks about.
That's right.
That you also mentioned. Son-in-law had an encounter with an ex-governor, which was extremely...
Yes. which was very amusing in a way, because RN Kao was much larger or bigger than any of these posts. So he never went on to become, because he lived, remember, his final innings was in Mrs. Gandhi's second innings from 1980 to 1984, when she was assassinated, in fact, on 31st October 1984. He was in Beijing. And he then quietly faded away after that, although Rajiv Gandhi did consult him and all that. But between 1984 and 2002, for 18 years, he did not aspire to become a governor or an ambassador or whatever. So he remained that private person, and he continued with being the mentorship of RNAW. And therefore, I would think the family really reveres him. His wife described him, when I asked her with great difficulty, that she said he was a saint. He was a saint. And many people have described him as that. In fact, his name is Ramji. He was known as Ramji. So General Manekshaw had great relations with him. So anybody who was touched by him, came in his contact, always had a good word about him. I haven't come across in my research or my interactions anybody saying anything that was negative about RN Kao, except one or two writings here and there that he favored sons and daughters of relations and associates. So RNAW for a while was known as
relatives and
associates, whatever, welfare, that way.
But some criticism, how did he deal with the post 1977, the emergency, when there were accusations that
RNAW was the Prime Minister, was convinced that RNAW was Mrs. Gandhi's Gestapo. And so he resigned a couple of months ahead of his normal retirement. But he had nurtured a great team under him. So the next man in line was K. Shankaran Nair, who I have described and others have mentioned as his alter ego, in a way, that completely two different personalities but worked together as a great team. But the number three that time was N.F. Santuk, former naval officer turned IFAS, that is the Indian Frontier Administrative Service, and then turned into RNAW operative. That man stabilized RNAW in its difficult years during the Janata Party government between 1977 and 1980. And that must be acknowledged, because RNAW otherwise would have not grown as it has now to become one of the finest external intelligence agencies.
There's lots more in that period, which won't give out, because the book should be read about
yes.
How foreign policy, India's foreign policy could have changed, whether we're talking about nuclear
NPT,
part there.
Yeah.
But apart from that, thanks, Nitin. I hope we haven't let out too many details and given enough of a teaser for people to go and get that book. And I'm also pretty sure that in 2027, when those three major files, Bangladesh, Sikkim and Indira Gandhi's assassination are open,
yes.
We'll see another book.
Of course you will. And thanks for this, because this is a book which must be read, not because I've written it. I've taken a great pleasure in doing it. I did not think I would do that in such a short time. But I managed to do it thanks to everybody's help, including our teams here and of course the organization to which he belonged. They could give me contacts and addresses of former people, retired people. Unfortunately, our declassification policy in India is still not firm. So there are no official papers that were available, and therefore it will remain an incomplete peep into RNAW and, more importantly, RN Kao.
Thanks so much, David.
Thank you.